Hello and welcome to the Legislative Journal for October 22 with State Representative Greg Vitali from the 166th Legislative District representing Delaware and Montgomery counties. Well, we are here coming to the end of session. What does that mean for the legislatures and the General Assembly and the session as a whole?
Well, another session has come and gone. You know, where's the time go? We end this two-year session on November 30th. Which means that any bill that is not passed in both chambers and up to the governor's desk is essentially dead needs to be brought back at the very start of next session as a new bill. It's called ending sign a die. And essentially we have three session days left after the election, and there's a feeling that after the election we shouldn't do too much of substance because members are no longer accountable since the election is over, so that period and those three session days, barring something unforeseen, will probably be reserved for members' retirement speeches and leadership elections. Leadership elections being the more significant of the two, because at the beginning of the new term, which will start at the beginning of the year, the first thing the House and the Senate, for that matter, does is reorganize and choose their, you know, leaders, who are about six or seven positions that really have a great deal of influence on the position the various caucuses take on the important issues. I myself hope one, to be reelected, and two, to reappointed chair of the Environmental Committee, which is all of that process. So where we are right now is, in a sense, wrapping things up. There was a significant crush of legislation in the final days of October, and we just essentially completed that as we take this show. So it's, in a sense, we're going into wrap-up mode.
Well, as you talked about, one of those things coming up here at the end of session is leadership elections. And one of the things that means also is that Representative Metcalf will no longer be the chair of the Energy and Resources, Environmental Energy and Resources Committee. What has that been like, having him in leadership across from you?
Darrell Metcalf, although I like him personally and wish him well, he's retiring and moving to Florida. Professionally, he's a climate denier and been very destructive to the environmental agenda of this chamber. Continues to cast doubt on climate change, continues at every turn to attempt to block important environmental regulations, stopping trying to stop REGGIE and VOC regs and other things. So we'll not miss him from a professional perspective at all, and hopefully the new speaker, presumably Speaker Cutler, will appoint someone who actually acknowledges the reality of climate change and will provide, conduct more balanced hearings on the various environmental issues of the day. I mean, the last hearing we had was a doozy. He brought a collection of four different climate deniers to his final hearing, and most of whom had testified in the past, but it almost really was the worst thing I had seen in a while.
Well, what is it like having these climate deniers in these hearings?
Well, because the hearings aren't balanced, it's very frustrating. So the best we can do, since there aren't speakers who represent mainstream science, I think the best we can do is really challenge them and get our message, the message of sound science, out, not through testimony, but through interrogation. So what we try to do, what I try to do as a chairman, is just confronting these people, sometimes in a very aggressive way, to really get the other side of the issue out.
Well, you did speak up and out against some of these speakers in that last hearing. Let's see what you had to say.
With regard to this hearing today, I must tell you, I am concerned with people who make a living selling books, accepting speakers' fees, accepting salaries from nonprofits by taking extremist, alarmist positions. You know, I mean, suggesting that, you know, our personal cars are going to be taken away. You know, they're going to come for our houses. We are you know, we're going to be drinking, you know, cockroach milk and climate lockdowns. No one is suggesting that. I've been working with regard to climate change in Pennsylvania for 30 years, and I can tell you that's not been suggested. And to sort of go around into this hearing and others, putting out these alarmists, false hearings, is not something I think it's disgraceful. Your positions are ridiculous and extremist, and they are not comporting with my real life experience and working with Pennsylvania climate policy for the last 30 years. That's absurdity. So my question to you, you talked a lot about politics. Do you acknowledge climate change is real? And by climate change being real, I mean human-induced climate change that we must address. I mean, do you acknowledge that is real? And if so, what do you propose to get us to carbon neutrality by mid-century?
So there may not have been any votes in this committee hearing, but the end of session is usually time to pass some bills last minute, maybe slip in some secretive language. And you spoke out against a tax subsidy for special interests. Could you just tell us a little bit more about that?
Right. Yeah. The name of the bill was House Bill 1059, which was really an unrelated bill that at the last second, an amendment, a secret agreement that was negotiated by the Republicans, Senate Republicans in the administration, was kind of slipped in. It's a technique so that that gives the public and rank and file members very little time to review it. It dealt with a couple of concepts. One was the hydrogen hub, and that's being sort of incentivized by federal money that's being made available by the Biden administration. And hydrogen has an important place in getting us to carbon neutrality if it's done right. But this particular bill really, in my view, was just perpetuates fossil fuel interests. And then the other piece of it, is actually an expansion of a tax break that was given a couple years back to a company called Nacero. It involves like a very experimental natural gas to gasoline process, which is not in existence. And frankly, in my view, is not needed, because these days we ought to be, you know, using less gasoline and switching to EVs as opposed to figuring out more ways to use more gasoline. So I, you know, struggled mightily to get the details of this. And then when it finally was sprung on us, did what I can to educate people as to why this bill was not a good idea.
Well, let's take a look at you rising on the House floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise and urge non-concurrence on House Bill 1059. This is, in effect, a $2.6 billion, B with a billion, tax subsidy for selected companies and interests in this Commonwealth, which we as a chamber, the language we received, most of us did not get this until this morning. So we're being asked to vote for a $2.6 billion tax break for favored businesses and entities that we just got the language for. You know, Mr. Speaker, with regard to my stakeholder letters, I usually don't lead off with the Commonwealth Foundation. But I know there are members on the other side of the aisle who share the concerns with progressives such as me. And it's interesting that the Commonwealth Foundation also seems to be opposing this. Although not mentioning this bill by name, they mention concerns about a proposed package of targeted tax breaks for selective corporations, and they call this misguided. Misguided, the Commonwealth Foundation said the following in a letter today. As this legislative session comes to a close, lawmakers should focus on giving every business a chance to succeed instead of striking backroom deals to give handouts to politically connected insiders. And in my view, this is what we have before us, essentially a backroom deal. What you have, in my view, is a few selected Senate Republicans want a $56 million tax break per year for 25 years for a company called Nacero to build a plant in Luzerne County. That's their end of the deal. And in exchange, the Wolf administration wants a questionable green hydrogen, not a green hydrogen, but a hydrogen hub program. That's the essence of this, something that was revealed to us and the public early this morning. Very interesting. Mr. Speaker, you'll remember Patrick McDonald, the former DEP secretary. He was, in fact, the DEP secretary under Wolf as late as this June, Wolf's DEP secretary. And in an op-ed opinion in today's Penn Live, he called this hydrogen hub concept that's captured in this bill, he says, quote, "This is a textbook case of greenwashing to disguise a lack of serious plans to decarbonize our economy. Billions of dollars in state subsidies to woo dirty hydrogen and petrochemical facilities could instead be used to support a significant amount of renewable energy and energy efficiency." So many of us have serious concerns about Nacero. Many of us have serious concerns about the hydrogen hub. That's what we're dealing with today. For those on the liberal side, you should know that the Conservation Voters, the Sierra Club, Clean Water Action, Clean Air Fund, all call for opposition to this. They say, and I'm quoting October 26th letter, "House Bill 1059 will be a massive gift to the fossil fuel industry, specifically to fracked gas, and will neither lead Pennsylvania into a sustainable green economy, nor will it guarantee good-paying union jobs. Penn Environment also opposing, quote, history will not look back on kindly on those elected officials who chose to subsidize climate pollution in the face of a climate crisis. Again, Penn Future confirming this, they say it's expected that the proposed Nacero fracked gas to gasoline facility in Luzerne County will receive most, if not all, of this subsidy. You know, I think what makes this massive $2.6 billion subsidy more troubling is it is saleable, it is assignable. We give tax subsidies, and their effects, frankly, are questionable, but we give tax subsidies to companies because we want certain interests developed. Why are we allowing them to sell or assign these tax credits? It makes no sense. It's wasteful. Is this how we are accountable for our constituents' monies? Because every time we give a tax credit, it's money we don't have to that our constituents, it could be used to help us and our constituents. Mr. Speaker, we as a chamber and our constituents are entitled to have massive ideas like this aired out. We are entitled to have public hearings. We are entitled to receive public comment. We are entitled to have bills of this importance move through the legislative process, can be heard in each chamber as our Constitution requires on three consecutive days, which has not happened here. And for that to happen, we need to have more time. So that's why I hereby move to table this bill.
So you moved to table this bill. What happened shortly after that?
Yeah, you know, I wanted to move the table because actually a Republican member came over to me prior to the vote and said that, you know, we have some Republican votes against this. I hope you can marshal up some Democratic votes. So I thought that rather than simply arguing against the bill on the House floor, it might have been an easier vote for some House members rather than to vote yes or no, to just vote to table. But it didn't go well. I thought we had a shot, but we didn't go well. And so we then moved to consider the bill on final passage. The bill passed. And now it goes to the governor's desk. The governor is going to sign it because it's a concurrence vote, but he is going to sign it because it was sort of part of the deal. I mean, Nacero, I maybe give you a little more background, is a Houston-based company, and they've not done one of these natural gas to gasoline facilities yet. I don't think anyone's done it in the country, and they've been trying to do it for a while. It's very experimental in nature, but it's not, frankly, something that I think we want to be doing. If you're going to invest something massive, like a $56 million a year tax credit for 25 years, I mean, you don't want to do it in perpetuating gasoline, because the wave of the future is to switch to EV vehicles, which use less gasoline. And so if you're going to invest that kind of money, what you want to, you know, it's much better spent, in my view, in charging stations and incentivizing EV vehicles. So in that way, you're using less gas. So you don't have to, you know, worry about incentivizing. But I think that, you know, the senator who represents Luzerne County, Udicek, he views this in terms of jobs and doesn't really factor in, you know, the environmental impact. And I think that's the problem. And I think the reason we lost this vote so substantially, and because they could not pass this without Democratic support, and a lot of Democrats voted yes on this bad bill. And I think, you know, one reason, I'm sure, is because the unions, building trades, the electricians, they weighed in on this and they encouraged, you know, Democratic House members to vote yes on this. And, you know, they have the Democrats' ears, frankly. You know, they help them win their elections. I mean, their endorsements mean something. The money they give the Democrats means something. The poll workers, the whole deal. I mean, getting union support is helpful. So that has honestly, as you look at the political dynamics of the battle for environmental protection in Pennsylvania in the past couple of years, labor unions have just been killing us. I'm not sure how you change that. I mean, they just view every issue through the narrow lens of their union jobs, not jobs generally, but their union jobs. And I think they're overbroad in how they are approaching this. And I maybe what you need to do is somehow reform unions so you don't have the old school labor leaders who take this attitude, but new progressive people who understand that the kind of future we need and how this is not gonna get us there. I mean, you expect Republicans, you expect conservatives, you expect climate deniers, you expect people, legislators from, you know, the gas patch to be supporting legislation like this, but not Democrats. And that's what's so disappointing and frustrating about a vote like this. You know, it wasn't even honestly close. And so I think that, you know, moving forward, and it's going to be a tough haul, elections really matter, and we have to get as many legislators elected who really understand the importance of dealing with climate change right now. I mean, my experience in dealing with this legislature is you're not changing people's minds. Like, you'll never change a Daryl Metcalf's mind. It's just not happening. You have to change who's in that seat. And that's why, you know, the November 8th election is so important. As is, you know, I'm not going to get too political, but even the PA governor's race, you have, you know, two very different views of climate change and environmental policy and to a need to address that. And if that outcome does not come out the way it should, you know, it doesn't, it bodes very poorly for, you know, the next 2 to 4 years in office. So, you know, elections really matter in the end. It's all about the numbers. Do you have the votes? And that's why it's important for people to get out and vote.
Well, you mentioned the governor's race. What are some of the other important races that are coming up for this November 8th election? The governor, U.S. Senate.
Yeah, so U.S. Senate, and you have Oz and Fetterman, governor of Mastriano Shapiro. Then you have U.S. House in our district, which I think is not sure how competitive that is. You have State House, my seat, and you have a State Senate seat too that I think Senator Carney's up for re-election. And then actually in Haverford Township, there is a special election for the first ward of Haverford Township. So you do have, honestly, some crucial races on the ballot. So it's important for people to vote one way or the other. I personally vote in person. I can. I'm at the polls anyway, doing my political thing. And it's just safe. It's secure. I mean, it's just tried and true. I don't have to worry about, am I going to get my absentee ballot in time, when to make the application, yada, yada, yada. I just go to the polls and vote. But people who are going to vote by mail, I mean, I would just be aware. Here are four polling locations. Haverford Township has drop boxes at the municipal building, you know, the new one, Darby and Manoa. The Radnor Township Municipal Building has a drop box where you can take your mail in. That's on Ivan Road. The Marple Library on Sproul Road has a drop box. And for our Lower Merion constituents, Ludington Library. So they are four drop box locations. I'm not sure I would encourage people to apply for mail-in ballots anymore. But if you got them, that's where you can drop them off. Just a reminder, the district lines have changed. The new 166, where I now am running for re-election, is all of Haverford Township and the eastern half of Marple Township, specifically Marple 1, Marple 2, Marple 3, and most of Marple Ward 4, with the exception of Marple 4-2. I don't represent any more of Radnor or Lower Merion, so you know, if you live there, try not to be too disappointed if you don't see my name on the ballot. So the important thing is just to, one way or the other, either in person or by mail, vote.
Well, we've only got about a minute left, so let people know how best to get in touch with you in your district office.
Sure. So we're at the corner of Darby and Manoa Roads in Havertown. We are now at full complement, three staffers all there. We can do notaries. We can do handicap placards, set the senior ID. And we are still maintaining that satellite office in Ardmore at the Ardmore Library on Thursdays from 10 to 2. So just give us a call, 610-789-3900.
Well, State Representative Greg Vitali, thank you for taking the time to join us today.
Well, thank you, and thanks again, and have a good rest of your day.